Do you remember what you got with your very first paycheck? Maybe you don't have a job yet. What are you gonna get with that first paycheck? Well, my best friend, he got a sound system for his car with one of those obnoxiously loud subwoofers. I remember riding along in his car and the bass would just beat me in the head. Boom, boom, boom. It was terrible. And I wondered, what's actually hitting me in the head? I mean, I kind of knew it was sound waves, but what are sound waves? It turns out that sound waves are a series of compressions of air itself. The air molecules get close together, far apart, close together, far apart. And it was these series of compressed air waves that were smashing me in the head. If we want to understand things like sound, and actually all sorts of other phenomena like light, earthquakes, we need to understand waves. In this lesson, we're going to take a good look at all the properties of waves. Let's learn. All right, team, let's start by reviewing our lesson objectives. First, we'll introduce transverse and longitudinal waves. Then we'll explain how waves are described. Just two lesson objectives this time. Okay, first up, what are longitudinal waves? Longitudinal waves are a forwards and backwards oscillation traveling through a medium. Okay, that's a dense definition. There's a lot going on there. Let's break that apart a little bit. The first word that might make you uncomfortable is oscillation. Know that an oscillation is just a repeated motion. And then also remember that a medium is just a material through which a wave propagates. Okay, so let's look back at that definition. A forwards and backwards oscillation traveling through a medium. So basically something is just repeatedly going forwards and backwards through some material. Let's look at an example. Here we have a spring, and those yellow arrows are showing the direction the hand is moving the spring. I personally like to think of this as a slinky, which is a little cooler. And if you have a slinky, you should totally get this out and give it a try. You shake the slinky forwards and backwards, and you'll notice that it compresses the slinky together at some points. Those are those dark regions. And at other regions, they get really expanded. And however many times you shake this slinky, that's how often there are going to be compressions. Okay, slinkies are one example where you can generate a longitudinal wave. But sound waves are another good example of longitudinal waves. You can even feel these compressed waves if you have the bass really loud. The rhythmic pounding you feel is the compressed air molecules hitting you in wave after wave. So sound waves are longitudinal waves. What's the medium? Well, the material through which they're propagating is air. Now, just a quick note, this isn't always the case. You could send sound through water, for example, no problem. But typically, when we experience sound, it's in air. For example, here is a tuning fork, which is shaking, and exactly at the frequency it shakes, it produces waves of compressions. So you can see all of those arrows coming from compression pointing to the points where the air molecules are really close together. Between them are expanded regions where the air molecules are farther apart than they would otherwise be. So sound waves compress and expand the space between molecules. And if we remove the medium, there's no sound. In space, you might have heard this before, you can't hear any sounds. Despite what you might see in the sci-fi movies, there's no sound in space. And that's because there's no air to communicate it. Okay, if you had a bunch of water, that would work too. But there's no medium in space, and so there's no sound. All right, now let's introduce transverse waves. Here we have another spring, or maybe a slinky. And notice the person's hand is, instead of going forwards and backwards, is going up and down. That makes a transverse wave. And in fact, when we look at the definition, we'll see it's an up and down oscillation traveling through a medium. And remember, a medium is just a material through which a wave propagates. These ocean waves are a good example of transverse waves. The water piles up into high repeated peaks and troughs. All the while, they're moving forward towards the shore. So remember that ocean waves are transverse waves. In this case, what's the medium? Well, you guessed it, the medium is water. Now, to describe transverse waves, we need a wavelength. You can actually describe longitudinal waves this way as well, but it's easier to see with transverse waves. And wavelength is just the distance from peak to peak. So wavelength is the length from peak to peak. If we look back at our ocean waves, we can realize that the wavelength would be the distance there between those two peaks. We can also describe the amplitude of a longitudinal or transverse wave, but it's easier to describe with our transverse waves. And the amplitude is just the height of a peak. So if we take another view at our ocean waves, we can see that how tall they are tells us the amplitude of that wave. Of course, it's pretty clear that this wave is also moving, and that's another way we can characterize our waves. They all have wave velocities, and it's just the speed at which the wave propagates. So if I were to watch this wave move forward in the direction of that white arrow, how quickly that happens would be its velocity. The wave velocity is related to another important property of waves, frequency. Frequency is essentially how frequently a peak passes a certain point. Here, frequency could be measured by how often a peak hits the shore. The more waves hitting the shore, the higher the frequency. So frequency is just a measure of how often a peak passes a given point per second. We measure that with the fancy unit called hertz. So frequency is measured with hertz, which just means per second. So I could say 60 times per second or 60 hertz, and that's the same thing. Here we see two waves, one with low frequency and one with high frequency. Notice that the one on the right is going to have a lot of peaks pass a given point at a given time, and that gives it a high frequency. Whereas the one on the left is going to have relatively fewer peaks and hence a low frequency. But you might also notice here that they have different wavelengths, and that's true. There's a relationship between frequency and wavelength. Here is the equation that dictates the relationship between frequency, v, which turns out to be velocity, and this weird Greek letter, which turns out to be wavelength. We'll actually use this equation in a later lesson, but I wanted to introduce the relationship between these variables now. So frequency depends on velocity. The faster the wave is moving, the higher the frequency. But it also depends on wavelength. The shorter the wavelength, the more peaks per second. So notice we're dividing by wavelength. That means that if the wavelength is short, we'll get a higher frequency. Okay, let's go ahead and put all of these ideas into practice. In each case, identify the word from the lesson that best matches each description. Pause the video and give this a try. First up, the height of a wave. What do we use to describe the height of a wave? Well, it's amplitude. What about the distance between two peaks? That turns out to be wavelength. How often a peak passes by? Well, how frequently does it pass by? That's frequency. D says sound travels through these waves. Well, that's longitudinal waves, when we have our forwards and backwards oscillations. E is ocean waves are examples of these waves. That would be transverse. And lastly, the material a wave travels through. Well, that's describing the medium. Let's review what we've learned. First, we introduced transverse and longitudinal waves. Transverse waves oscillate up and down, and longitudinal waves oscillate forwards and backwards. Lastly, we explained how waves are described with things like amplitude, wavelength, and frequency. Hey, hey.